Love you, Shirley.
Good morning.
I like your outfit.
Thank you.
Love it, love it.
I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation.
Good morning, everyone. We have a very toasty morning, don't we? You can already feel it in the air, right? So it is awesome to be here with you this morning. We're going to start off this morning a little bit differently, right? So I hope you have your bulletins, whatever you want to call them. If not, you can kind of maybe look on with someone else. We're going to begin with a praise chorus. It's a new praise chorus. Very, very simple. This is the idea behind it. We are gathered here primarily for one main goal, and that is to worship King Jesus. And this song in just four lines puts it so clearly. And so if you look in your bulletin, you have all hail King Jesus, all hail the Lord of heaven and earth, all hail King Jesus, all hail the Savior of the world. And we're just going to sing that three or four times together. It may take you the first time to kind of get the rhythm of it. Me and Mandy are going to be leading you. And then we would love for you just with however you want to worship, whether you want to stand up or sit down, arm raise, whatever, we are praising King Jesus for what he has done for us. All hail King Jesus. Jesus, we have come here this morning to praise you, for you are worthy. You are worthy of our worship. Lord, you are Lord. over all of heaven and earth, over our entire lives, over everything we have going on. Not only that, you are Savior of the world. You have proved your love for us. You came into our world, the world that you created, the world that you so desperately loved, taking on flesh, becoming like us, and then going to the cross and taking on our sins so that we might be saved, so that we could gather here August 2nd, 2020. Different backgrounds, different places that we come from, but with one purpose we come to say, all hail King Jesus, for you alone are King of our lives and King of this world. We love you. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your sacrifice. And we just hope that everything we do in word and in song and in prayer and in scripture this morning honors you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you have your scriptures with you this morning, I will have you turn to Psalm 86 real quickly. Psalm 86, reading it this week and just found this to be such a beautiful prayer. A beautiful prayer that we are going to use this morning as sort of a template, we might say, as we pray together. And you can follow along. I'm going to be reading from Christian Standard, but Psalm 86, a prayer of David. And listen to what he says. Listen, find his heart in this prayer. It says, "Listen, Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Protect my life, for I am faithful. You are my God. Save your servant who trusts in you. Be gracious to me, Lord, for I call to you all day long. Bring joy to your servant's life, because I appeal to you, Lord." And so I want us to think through this just for one quick moment before we pray. And look at just David's heart. His understanding of who God is. That he doesn't have to hide his brokenness. He doesn't have to hide his neediness, his weakness. That he is able to just simply go into God's presence as he is. As a sinner broken who needs, a broken sinner who needs help. And he simply just cries out to God, "Lord, Lord, would you listen to me? And then would you answer? Because I come to you, I am poor and I am needy." And isn't that the way that we all normally come to God? Hopefully just poor and needy. With no pretense, no pride. This is who I am, God. I am poor and needy. But I know that you can make me more than I am. I need you. And he appeals, he says, "You are my God. You're not just a distant, mighty God, but you are my personal God. You are my Father. You are the God that I know." And that is the access that every single one of us as Christians has to our Heavenly Father through Jesus Christ. He is our God. He is our Heavenly Father through Jesus. And he goes on to say, "Lord," what a simple prayer, "be gracious to me. Lord, show me grace, because if I don't have your grace, I am nothing. If I don't have your grace, I won't be able to make it through the day. And then bring joy to your servant's life." Lord, we desire to be joyful people. We don't want to be bitter. We don't want to be angry. We don't want to be discontent. Lord, we want to be joyful people that reflect your goodness. So let's go to God in prayer. And this is what I want to do. I want to start out, and I'm just going to give you a time of silence. Maybe a specific line spoke to you. Maybe something in your heart was, you know, quickened there in that prayer and that thought of this scripture. And I just want you to give you time, you and the Heavenly Father, to pour out your heart to Him with whatever you need. So let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, I don't know about everyone else that's here, that's tuned in. But even this past week, Lord, I've just been so aware of my neediness and my weakness, how poor I really am. And yet how rich I am in You. How blessed we are as Your people to have not only access, but an invitation at any point, at any second of our lives to run into Your presence, to run, to climb into Your lap as our Heavenly Father and just to pour out our heart to You. The good, the bad, the ugly. Lord, there's no need. Why do we hide from You? Lord, You know the hairs on our head. You can count the stars. You name the stars. You know everything about us. Why would we dare try to hide from You? Lord, in Your grace, in Your mercy, help us to stop hiding and help us just to find that freedom that we find in Christ, that we have been covered by His blood. We have been declared righteous, and so that we can come to You and not find condemnation, not find shame or guilt, but we can find love and restoration and strength and unending joy. And God, as we poured out our hearts just a moment ago, I can only imagine some of the struggles that people poured out to You, things that are wrecking their lives right now, things that are so beyond their power to control or do anything about, Lord, and they're just coming to You in need. And I pray that You would meet them in their suffering, in their need, and show them to be the God that we know that You are, the God of Scripture, the God that's above all other gods, the God that's above all other problems. Lord, I think of my dear friend Ashley and the passing of her father a couple days ago, and just how raw and how painful this time has been. Lord, I think of all the dear friends we have in our congregation, brothers and sisters that are still for years now battling cancer, and how tired and weary they must be. And I pray, Lord, that even this very second that You would remind them of Your promise that when we are tired, when we are weary, when we need rest, Lord Jesus, You invite us to come to You, for Your yoke is light. You're able to carry our burdens. You're able to carry us. Remind all of us, whatever our struggle is, Lord, not to try to bear it on our own shoulders and our own strength, but to turn it over to You. Lord Jesus, we pray for those in our life, family, friends, co-workers, who do not know You in a saving way, who have never trusted You for salvation. Lord, we pray that whatever they are clinging to, that You would help them to see the emptiness of it, that it would never satisfy them, that You alone can satisfy them and bring them joy. You alone can save them from their sins. And God, that You would then send us out today, the rest of this week, the rest of our lives, to go to them and to live holy lives and to share what You have done for us, what You have done for them. Share the good news of Jesus Christ. God, would You give us that burden for that one, for that two, for however many people You've placed in our lives that we have that burden for, to share the good news, Lord, so they might come to know You in a saving way and find eternal life. God, we pray Your blessing upon the rest of this service. You would help us to stay focused on You, that, Lord Jesus, You would be honored and glorified. And God, we pray for all those who are not able to meet with us for different reasons, God, that You would continue to bless them and watch over them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to grab your bulletin, stand again. We're going to sing Nothing But the Blood and When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Survey the wondrous cross.
Oh.
to consider the wondrous cross, the blood that you shed. Lord, the only proper response is for us to say, Lord, here am I. You can have it all. I am yours. And God, we know that we don't do that perfectly, that we are oftentimes selfish, seeking to live for ourselves and form our own kingdoms. But God, we pray that each day that you would humble us with the cross. You would humble us with the love that we have been shown, this amazing love that you have demonstrated to us, so that we would give our everything to you, to follow you, to be your disciples. Now, as we come to your word, we pray that you would begin to work in us through your word, that you would chip away at our pride, that you would convict us of our sins, and that you would encourage us in our weakness. Holy Spirit, have your way with us, with our hearts and with our minds, and transform them in the way that only you can. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. If you want to go ahead while I transition and turn to Ecclesiastes 5, verse 8. So, as I've mentioned many times before, one of my favorite authors is C.S. Lewis. And he wrote a seven-part series years ago. Who's ever heard of the Chronicles of Narnia? Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe, those books. I don't know if you've read them or maybe watched some of the movies. One of my favorite books in that seven-part series is called The Voyage of the Dawn Treader. It's really the third part of the series. And at the very beginning of The Voyage of the Dawn Treader, you are introduced to a young boy named Eustace. And if any of you have ever read the books or watched the movies, as soon as you heard Eustace, you're like, oh, that kid. Because C.S. Lewis painted for us the perfect portrait of what we don't want to be. Eustace is the most self-centered, whiny, wimpy, bratty little kid you could ever imagine. When he first comes into the stories and the other Pevensey kids who are kind of the heroes of the story outside of Aslan, they can't stand him because he is so bratty. They don't want anything to do with him. Well, Eustace is going along with these adventures. They're sailing on ships and they finally come to this island. This one island. And on this island, Eustace has had it with these other do-gooders. He just goes off on his own, doesn't tell anybody where he's going. And as he's making his way across this uninhabited island, he stumbles upon this treasure. And we're talking about hordes and hordes of gold. You know, just imagine, you know, mounds and mounds of gold and gems and bracelets and crowns and swords. Just like, you know, just something that you just want to grab and take home. Well, Eustace in the back of his mind knows maybe something's a little bit up, but he just can't help himself because remember, Eustace is all about himself. And part of his downfall, part of his heart is he's greedy. And so he begins to grab everything he can. He's storing gold, he's grabbing gems, and then all of a sudden he grabs this bracelet. This humongous, you know, million-dollar bracelet, and he slides it on his wrist. And all of a sudden he falls asleep. But when he wakes up, In the way that only Lewis can, you know, write in a book, he has been transformed into what he really is. It's a dragon. Eustace's heart is shown in what he becomes. His greedy nature has been shown for what it really is, and he becomes this dragon. You know, this horrible, wretched, scaly creature that no one wants to be around. And it's all because of his greed. Whether you are Karis's age, you're 9, whether you're a teenager, whether you're adults, greed is a danger force, isn't it? Whether it be money and possessions, wealth, or whether it be something else, greed is a danger for every single one of us. And this is what the preacher Solomon hones in for us this morning: the dangers of greed. And so if you would, look in Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 8, where we're going to begin this morning. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 8. And this is what he begins with. If you see oppression of the poor and perversion of justice and righteousness in the province, don't be astonished at the situation. Because one official protects another official and higher officials protect them, the profit from the land is taken by all. The king is served by the field. The one who loves silver is never satisfied with silver, and whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with income. This too is futile. When good things increase, the ones who consume them multiply. What then is the profit to the owner except to gaze at them with his eyes? The sleep of the worker is sweet, whether he eats little or much, but the abundance of the rich permits him no sleep. There is a sickening tragedy that I have seen under the sun. Wealth kept by its owner to his own harm. So the very beginning of this passage, and we're going to read through the end of chapter 6 by the time we're done, begins with Solomon's understandings of the dangers of greed. And really, like only Solomon can do, he's going to do more than just say, hey, listen, greed's bad. Don't do it. Don't be greedy. He is going to paint for us the most realistic, real-life picture that we can identify with, that we can see in other people, maybe we can even see in our own heart, to show us why greed is so dangerous. The normal dictionary definition for greed is excessive desire for something, normally money or possessions. So it's two things. I want to stop there. So while we normally primarily think of greed as wanting money excessively or wanting possessions excessively, I don't want us to say, oh, well, I don't deal with greed. I don't care about money or possessions, so I'm off the hook this morning. Because greed, again, can be an excessive desire for anything. So don't tune out the preacher yet. Listen to him all the way through and see if maybe he's speaking to you and he wants to help you in your walk with Christ. But the other word I want us to focus on here for us as Christians is the word excessive. Because for us, the word excessive means sinful. The preacher's not going to tell us that, hey, listen, you shouldn't have money, you shouldn't be rich, you shouldn't have new cars, you shouldn't have big houses, you shouldn't have a very successful company. What he's going to say is when that drive, when it becomes excessive, when you become a slave to it, when it becomes more important than following Christ, that's when you've got a problem. That's when it becomes sin. So let's jump right in verse 8. The first danger we see, the first problem with greed, is that greed leads to oppression and injustice. And this is a way for me to tell if y'all are awake or not. If when I was reading verse 8 and 9, if you weren't thinking in your head, amen, then something's wrong. Because look in verse 8 again. If you see oppression of the poor and perversion of justice and righteousness in the province, don't be astonished at the situation, because one official protects another official and higher officials protect them. The profit from the land is taken by all. The king is served by the field. Don't we see that all around our world? The powerful oppressing the poor, those who have it all stepping on top of other people, injustice, unrighteousness all around. one official protecting another official who protects another official who's protected by a higher official all the way to the king? Can I get an amen, right? And doesn't it frustrate you? It should eat at you. It's what the Bible says. We should be righteously angry at that. As Christians, we should be angry when the poor, when the righteous are oppressed by those who are abusing their power. Right? And it doesn't just have to be government, does it? You hear about it in churches. You hear about it in workplaces. It's anybody who has been blessed by God with power and they abuse that power. And the preacher is saying that greed leads to that. That when you are greedy, you can get to the point where you begin to cut corners. You step on the little guy to get to that next rung on the corporate ladder. You'll do whatever it takes. Why? Because you need another buck. You want to earn more money. You need more riches. You need more income. That greed can lead that to even the highest up leaders can be corrupted by greed, all because they want more. Not only that, which I think is really, for me, spoke to me the most this week, is the next point. The greedy are never satisfied. The greedy are never satisfied. Look in verse 10. The one who loves silver is never satisfied with silver, and whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with income. This too is futile. No matter what they gain, no matter how much they're able to hoard or to put in their banks, it is never enough. They very likely start out, you know, if I could just earn a little bit more, if I could reach this dollar amount, if I could reach this much, if I could just have this or this or this, I would be content. But once they get to that point, it's not enough because their hearts are greedy. Their hearts want more. And there's never going to be a certain dollar amount or a certain amount of possessions they have that's going to make them content. Because the greedy person is never satisfied. They always want more. The famous philosopher Socrates has great wisdom for us. He who is not contented with what he has would not be contented with what he would like to have. Isn't that so true? If you cannot find contentment in what God has blessed you with, what makes you think when you have $1 million you're going to be content? If you're not content with what God has blessed you with right now, why do you think you're not going to be greedy and you're going to be content with what you have when you have more? All this is the problem of greed. A little more is never enough because it comes down to a heart issue. There's something wrong with our heart. Our heart longs for money. Our heart longs for possessions. Our heart longs for some other excessive desire more than we long for Christ. And because we long for anything in the world more than Christ, we're never going to be satisfied. We're always going to want something more, and that is the problem of the greedy. It's why Paul writes to Timothy, a young pastor, in 1 Timothy chapter 6, a very familiar passage. This wind's making it a little tricky this morning. Listen to these words, so relevant to this morning. Paul writes to Timothy, and he says, "If we have food and clothing, we will be content with these. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation, a trap, and many foolish and harmful desires which plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and by craving it, some have wandered away from faith and pierced themselves with many griefs." So Paul, writing to Timothy, says, hey, listen, greed is no simple sin. It's no little bitty sin that's like, oh, this is just trivial, don't worry about it. Because greed is a temptation. It's a trap. Maybe it's something that we never could foresee ourselves falling into. I would never be greedy. I'm always been content. And then all of a sudden we're stuck. And all we want is more. We're never satisfied. Paul says that greed can literally plunge us into ruin and destruction. Can money ruin people? Yeah, we've seen it happen before, right? And that's what Paul's writing thousands of years ago. Timothy, beware of greed. Because it can lead people who think it's a little trap, it's no big deal, it's a little temptation. It can lead them into ruin and destruction, even causing people to wander away from the faith. And we say, well, how in the world is that possible? Because all of a sudden, money, possession, something else is their God. If I have $1 million in my bank account, if I'm a CEO, if I have everything that brings me pleasure, why do I need God? I have it all. He says, beware of greed. Look in chapter 6. Look in chapter 6, verse 3. Chapter 6, verse 3, he continues this idea of greedy, not being able to be satisfied. Look what he says. A man may father 100 children and live many years. No matter how long he lives, if he is not satisfied by good things and does not even have a proper burial, I say that a stillborn child is better off than he. For he comes in futility and he goes in darkness, and his name is shrouded in darkness. Though a stillborn child does not see the sun, is not conscious, it has more rest than he. And if a person lives 1,000 years twice, but does not experience happiness, do not both go to the same place? All of a person's labor is for his stomach, yet the appetite is never satisfied. Look back at that proverb. We're going to start the proverb and then go back to verse 3. All of a person's labor is for his stomach, yet the appetite is never satisfied. He's still talking about greed. He's talking about someone who just works and works and works to be satisfied, but is he ever satisfied? No, he's always hungry. You ever been around someone that just got done at when we could go to the buffet? You know, the old Western Steer buffets, you know? And they eat and they eat and they eat, and you're getting done with your main meal, and all of a sudden you look up and they're going back again. And then you finally get done with like your dessert, and they're going back again. They're not even to the dessert yet. And you're like, how in the world are they still eating? It's like their appetite is never satisfied. This proverb is saying the same thing about greed. The same thing can be true of any excessive desire. If we don't learn contentment and we are greedy, we're never going to be satisfied. And so he illustrates this with a very interesting verse 3, starting verse 3, a story. The idea is to paint the picture of what would be a very blessed life. Look in verse 3. A man may father 100 children and live many years, no matter how long he lives. If he's not satisfied by good things and does not have a proper burial, I say that a stillborn child is better off than he. So Solomon in his day paints the picture of someone that would be considered blessed. Someone to have 100 children, wow, God has blessed them. How many years they live, they surely are blessed. But what does he say about that person? Even if he has riches, even if he has 100 children, even if he lives in verse 6, 1,000 years twice, if he cannot be satisfied with what God has given him, what? It's better, what? A stillborn child. Now, if you're like me, you're like, wow, what a very difficult illustration to use, but hopefully you capture his point. That a stillborn child is born not alive, so that they never experience the futility. They never experience the pain and the darkness that someone who is never content will experience all their days. It is better to never be awakened to greed and go through that than to experience the life of someone who has it all and yet they're never satisfied. Why? Because they're going to be miserable. It's futile. Greed causes us, like he said very often, greed is futile. It's a chasing after the wind, because you're never going to be satisfied. You're always going to be chasing after something that you can never catch. There's always going to be more, and it's going to make you miserable. It's going to bring ruin to your life. He goes on in verse 11. Look in verse 11, chapter 5. Sorry, the preacher jumps around, so I jump around. In verse 11, when good things increase, the ones who consume them multiply. What then is the profit to the owner? except to gaze at them with his eyes. What's the problem with greed? The greedy attract other greedy people. The more money you earn, guess what? The more friends you have that want what? Your stuff. They want your money. He says, the more that the good things increase, the more those who want it multiply. They're all of a sudden all around you. And what can the owner do? The owner just has to watch. The owner's miserable because even the stuff he's earned is now going in some place to other people. Look in verse 12. The greedy can't even sleep because of their misery. The sleep of the worker is sweet, whether he eats little or much, but the abundance of the rich permits him no sleep. I love this idea. The idea of a worker who just goes about their work, and at the end of the day, what? They eat, they drink, they're happy, they're content, they sleep, but not the rich person, not the greedy person. The greedy person can't even sleep because their mind is so consumed with earning more. That's all they can think about. They're miserable even in their sleep. In verse 13, the greedy person harms themselves. Verse 13, Solomon writes, "There is a sickening tragedy I have seen under the sun. Wealth kept by its owner to his harm." So greed not only leads to oppression of other people, it might not only harm other people, it literally harms yourself. It brings harm upon yourself. You know, there are, sometimes it's kind of helpful to think in this, not that they're different really, in God's eyes, but you know, there are very obvious sins in the world, aren't there? You know, you can be around certain people and it's obvious that they are an alcoholic. Or, you know, it's obvious to see someone if they're caught in adultery. It's obvious if you're around someone who lies and lies and lies and lies, right? I mean, if someone is very mean-spirited and angry, it's obvious. But then there are some pretty private sins. And sometimes the private sins are the most dangerous, aren't they? Because no one sees them. You live with them for weeks and then months and then years. And they eat at you and they grow and they fester and like cancer. They take over everything. And unless there are blatant outbursts in some way, no one knows you're dealing with that. No one knows that you are consumed with it. And that's the way of greed. Think about it. You can be a very private, greedy person. And so you can live with that. And Solomon says, but in the end, whether you realize it or not, it's causing you harm. It's causing you harm, not only because of our relationship with God, it's drawing us away from Him. We no longer worship Him, following Him. We're following that money. It's harming us in that way. But just practically, you're not sleeping. You're not a nice person. You're miserable. It harms you. And just for a little sidebar, this is why at Germantown Baptist, we believe community and fellowship and accountability are so important. Because if I'm dealing with greed and I don't have someone that's close to me that I've given permission, that I've invited into my life to love me in a hard way, to share truth with me, to point out like, Philip, I've been observing, you know, something's different. Are you struggling with greed? You know, that's important in our lives, or else these private sins continue to fester and grow and grow, and they ruin us and they destroy us. And the whole while we have hundreds of Christians that are part of our fellowship around us, and we've never allowed them or invited them to come into our life and help our life to help us. How many of us right now are dealing with private sins that are ruining us, and we have no one in our life to speak to us, no one to pray for us, no one to help us, no one to point it out, because we're doing everything solo? Let me invite you, if you don't have that person, pray and pray and pray. Invite people. Spend time with people. Love people. Be vulnerable so that things like greed can be nipped in the bud, can be taken care of. They can help us with that. The greedy person harms themselves. I love the way the New English Translation puts it. They put, "Here's a misfortune on earth that I've seen. Wealth hoarded by its owner to his own misery." Misery, that's what it brings upon the person. A greedy person is miserable. Finally, the last danger he shares. Riches riches and wealth are fleeting. They're fleeting. Anybody remember the recession of 2008? Remember how bad it was? I don't know if it was Facebook at the time or just the news. I remember seeing these heartbreaking videos of New York City, the financial district, seeing grown men jump out windows of skyscrapers. I don't know if you ever saw it. Hopefully you can't find the video, but you can read articles about it, where they showed up that morning with all that they ever needed, right? Money, position, and then all of a sudden, one day it's gone, right? All their riches, everything they've been working maybe for decades to earn working hard. I'm not talking about greedy people. I'm just talking about the reality of people who have worked their whole life for something and then said, hey, that's my identity. I've lost everything. And rather than build it back up, they jump out a window and take their own life. In one day, in the course of a week in 2008, people lost everything, didn't they? Businesses lost everything. It's the reminder, whether it's that or a fire or something else, that riches and stuff, anything here on earth, can be here one day and gone the next second, can it? Everything is fleeting, including riches and wealth. And this is what the preacher hones in on now. Look at verse 14. In verse 14, Solomon writes that wealth, remember the wealth that the greedy person has hoarded? That wealth was lost in a bad venture. So when he fathered a son, he was empty-handed. As he came from his mother's womb, so he will go again naked as he came. He will take nothing for his efforts that he can carry in his hands. This too is a sickening tragedy. Exactly as he comes, so he will go. What does the one gain who struggles for the wind? What is more, he eats in darkness all his days with much frustration, sickness, and anger. Solomon observes the greedy person who has hoarded all this wealth. All of a sudden, in one bad business venture, where's the wealth? It's gone, isn't it? Have y'all ever heard of the millionaire sports stars who retire and they go into some kind of venture, and what happens? Money's gone. So imagine earning over the course of your career. Let's just say you're a medium, you're a halfway good athlete, and 10-year career, you earn $100 million. So at the end of your career, you have $50 million. You talk to someone and they say, hey, listen, I've got this airtight business venture. I'm going to double your money in a year. They pour all their money into it, and then what happens to the money? It's gone. Everything that they saved up for, this might be a very smart person too, but the point of the preacher here is not that, they made a bad decision necessarily, but that their riches are gone like that. They can't depend on it. Why depend on riches and wealth if you can lose it in one bad venture? In one bad venture, it is completely gone. He goes on to say, in verse 15 to 16, the reality that we understand, just as he came from his mother's womb, which would be with no riches, he now has to return to the grave with no riches. Why? One bad venture, all of his riches are gone. He doesn't even have a dime to give to his son as an inheritance, which was expected, wasn't it, back in these days? That you would pass on everything you have. They don't have anything because riches are fleeting. He says, to kind of sum it up in verse 17, what is more, this person is so miserable that his riches are gone. His God is gone. He eats in darkness all of his days. He's frustrated, sick, and angry. Look in chapter 6. Here is a tragedy I've observed under the sun that weighs heavily on humanity. God gives a person riches, wealth, and honor so that he lacks nothing of all that he desires for himself, but God does not allow him to enjoy them. Instead, a stranger will enjoy them. This is futile and a sickening tragedy. This is another way of him teaching us the truth that, hey, don't put your trust in riches because they'll be gone just like that. We have another rich person. Solomon doesn't really give us an example of what he means by a stranger enjoying all the riches instead of what God has blessed this person with. But again, I go back to the sports athlete. Because I've heard of so many who put all their faith in a friend or a person, and all of a sudden their money's gone. Someone who had it all, and then a stranger somehow takes it all. So that this rich person who was blessed by God, notice, right? Solomon says it's God who blesses you with everything you have. Everything we have is a gift from God. But he says just like that, it's gone because of a stranger. Germantown, do not put your trust, do not put your hope, do not put your satisfaction and fulfillment in anything that you can lose like that. Ultimately, don't put your ultimate satisfaction or your hope in something that can be taken from us, and we don't even know. You might not even make a mistake, and it's gone. Our hope, our satisfaction, our fulfillment is only found in Jesus Christ, which we can never lose. And then we're able to enjoy those other things. What's the preacher's point? All the money, all the possessions, anything that caused you to be greedy, any excessive desire can be taken from you. The preacher has given us a raw, realistic picture of the dangers of a greedy heart. Oppression leads you to oppress others. You're never satisfied. It harms yourself. You can't sleep. It attracts other greedy people who will swarm you. You're going to lose it in no time. So here's a question for every single one of us. Are we slaves to our desires, specifically maybe money and possessions, things that bring us happiness? Are we slaves to those things? Or are we slaves to Christ? Do those things run our life? Do they control our life? Or does Christ control our life? Because those are two very different things, and you can't straddle the fence. You can't be controlled by your money and possessions and also be living for Christ. It's one or the other. So which are we slaves to? In Romans 6:22, Paul says that all who are in Christ, so anyone who has trusted Jesus Christ for salvation is saved. You have been set free from sin, like greed, any other desires, and you are now slaves of God. Meaning now you belong to God. You live for God. Your ultimate desire is to worship and to live for Him. So, what advice is Solomon going to give to us? He has given us a very good picture of what to look out for. Maybe he's given a picture of your own heart in some way. What advice is he going to give us? Well, I can tell you that he gives us the best advice possible. Because Solomon doesn't end this passage and say, hey, because this might happen to you, don't be greedy. Right? That'd be the simple answer, but it wouldn't help us at all. Because we all know we shouldn't be greedy. Instead, what he does is he gives us a better vision. He gives us a better answer, and that answer is to enjoy God's blessings. Look in chapter 5, verse 18. Chapter 5, verse 18. Solomon says, here is what I've seen to be good. It is appropriate. I mean, it's good. It's right. To eat, drink, and experience good in all the labor one does under the sun during the few days of his life God has given him. Because that is his reward. Furthermore, everyone to whom God has given riches and wealth, he has also allowed him to enjoy them. Take his reward and then rejoice in his labor. This is a gift of God. For he does not often consider the days of his life because God keeps him occupied with the joy of his heart. So Solomon says the answer here to greed is to find contentment. And to find contentment, we begin by first understanding that God has given us riches, wealth, and hey, let's remember something. If we live in America, what's the percentage chance that we're rich? Right here, about 100% right now, right here, we are considered rich. So if God has given us riches, he's given us wealth, he's given us things to be happy in, what does God want us to do? Be happy in them. Not worship them, not have an excessive desire for them, but simply be grateful for them and enjoy them. Did you ever think about that? one of the greatest ways you can worship God every day is to be grateful for what He's given you and enjoy it. Do you think God finds joy in looking down on His children, enjoying what He's blessed us with? Do you as a parent or grandparent or aunt or uncle, do you find joy if you give your son, daughter, grandchild, you give them a gift and they are just over the moon about it and they enjoy it and they sit there and play with it and they just can't stop thanking you for it? You're blessed by that in the same way that God is blessed when we enjoy His stuff. So the answer to greed, to excessive desires, is to realize the blessing we have been given by God and everything He's blessed us with, and to be grateful and enjoy it. Enjoy what God has blessed you with. And enjoying God's gifts and gratitude is a primary way every day that you and I can worship God. But I love what Pastor Phil Ryken says. He says, the gift that God gives us and the power to enjoy those gifts come separately. The gifts that God gives us and the power to enjoy those gifts come separately. This is why having more money can never guarantee that we'll find any enjoyment. Without God, we will still be discontent. So how do we fight against greed? We fight against greed by keeping God center of everything. What does that mean? It means, God, You are the giver of every single good gift. Come thy fount of every blessing, right? God is the source of every one of our blessings. And if we keep Him at the center of everything we do, of every blessing we have, then we're not going to be as likely to be distracted with following after those things that God has given us. Why would I worship the gift instead of the giver? Why would I worship what He's given me instead of the one who loves me so much that He's blessed me with that gift? So keeping God front and center is a primary way for us to fight against any excessive desire that we might be struggling with. And then Paul brings it all together by giving us really the key to this and being able to keep God the center. And that is in Romans 8, 13, 14, he says, for if you live according to the flesh, living according to the flesh would be giving in to greed and other excessive desires, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. And so as Paul often does, he brings us back to the Spirit versus the flesh. Every single day, will we be driven by desires of the flesh? Will we follow those desires to their end? Or will we trust in the Spirit who God has given us, who encourages us, who guides us, who leads us, who empowers us? Will we follow the leading of the Spirit and reject? Or as Paul says, the Spirit will put to death the deeds of the body. And that is our goal every single day. Holy Spirit, help me to put to death. Holy Spirit, You put to death those deeds of the flesh. Those deeds of the flesh that are going to lead me to worship something else other than God. So every single day, whether we're fighting greed, jealousy, pride, lust, discontentment, whatever we are fighting, don't fight the battle alone. God has given you the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, God Himself dwells in you, the person of the Holy Spirit, to help you fight against those deeds of the flesh, to put them to death so that you can worship God alone. Ask for help. Ask for strength, ask for discernment, follow the Spirit and not the flesh. Let me close us in prayer. God, as we come to these final moments of the service and we have the opportunity to reflect, and as Your Word always calls us to do, Lord, to respond. God, help us to be aware, to be able to discern those sins that are in our hearts, those excessive desires that Solomon talks about, whatever they are. Lord, help Satan not to veil those Help the world not to convince us that they're no big deal, but help us to see every single desire that's excessive, every desire of the flesh is an attack on us, is an attack on our ability to worship you. And God, I pray for every one of my brothers and sisters here this morning, God, that we would have such a beautiful, majestic, glorious picture of you that we would not even entertain the thought of having excessive desires for anything else. Because you alone are enough for us. You are the giver of every good gift. You are the Savior of our soul. You are the Lord of heaven and earth. And Lord, that you would remind us of that every single day in our time of prayer, in our time of Bible study, in our time with others. So that whenever we are tempted with some other excessive desire to follow after that, Lord, that we would simply turn our back and turn to you. Because you alone are worthy of our worship and our lives. Lord, as Paul says, we are now slaves to you because you have bought us. You have paid the price. You have purchased us with the blood of Christ. So that now we are your sons and daughters. And Lord, I pray that you would help every single one of us to find freedom from those sins. Lord, we know it's going to be a battle. Some of us have been fighting these battles for decades with the same sin. And Lord, sometimes we want to give up. Don't let us give up. Help us to stay the course. Help us to fight the good fight. Help us to trust the Spirit and the strength He can give us. Lord, I pray for anyone that's gathered with us this morning, whether they're a child or teenager or adult, whether they're tuned in to Facebook Live, they watch it later on. God, help them to see that this is much more than a talk or a sermon, a message about money and riches. That at the heart of this, it's about our heart. And if they're not following you, if they're not worshiping you, they're worshiping something else. They're following something. Something else is calling the shots. And help them to see that they're never going to be satisfied, that they're always going to be left feeling empty if they're following after something else, but that you promise eternal life. You promise a new life. You promise a salvation from sins, forgiveness from every sin, past, present, and future. Lord, you promise it all for them if they would simply turn from their sins and ask you to come and to save them. And Lord, that they would live for you. God, if we can help them as a church to make that decision, to talk more about that decision, God, we desire to do that, Lord, and help them to reach out to us. But God, send us out this week to live in the freedom of this passage, to put to death these excessive desires, and to live wholly for you. And we pray that the way we live our lives would be a testimony to others watching us so that we can speak the truth of what you have done through Jesus. We love you. We thank you for all your blessings. God, you are so good to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless everyone. Just a reminder, if you have brought your tithes and offerings and you're looking for where to drop that off, the box right behind me is a place for that. So if you need anything, please come and see me. Have a great evening. I felt bad too. Yeah, that's funny. Mandy? Hey everyone, I'm so sorry to bother you and interrupt your wonderful fellowship right now, but a shameless plug, we are beginning back our theology reading group. You may have received an email about it. Don't let the word theology scare you. We are all growing in our knowledge of God together. We're beginning what it looks like is throughout a month you read a book, not a lot of pages, maybe 5-10 a day. And then we gather together as a group and we discuss it, truths of God, how it applies to our life. If you're even interested at all in that idea, I would love to share more about it with you. It's open to anyone. And I have already purchased your first book for you, so you don't even have to go out and buy it, right? So it's like no risk, okay? So if you're interested in that, please come. If you're part of the group already, please come grab your book so you can jump in. Anyway, thank y'all.